I'm Jim Denison with Denison Forum, and I'm here today with my very dear friend, Dr. Michael Lindsay. We're making an announcement together that I am so honored to participate in and be able to share with you. But before we get to that, into the conversation I'm excited to have, let me say just a few words by way of introduction. I don't know that Dr. Lindsay is going to like this much, but I have to tell you that he is absolutely one of the most esteemed, one of the most respected evangelical scholars in the world. His degrees are from Baylor, from Princeton Seminary, from Oxford University, a PhD from Princeton University, taught sociology at Rice University before being called to be president of Gordon College, perhaps the only evangelical university in New England, one of the finest evangelical universities in the world. His first solo work was nominated for a Pulitzer Prize. His work has appeared with New York Times, Wall Street Journal, CNN, Fox, lectured on six continents, just an absolutely remarkable scholar in the larger Christian world. But I am so grateful for his friendship. It was my privilege to be his wife's pastor in Dallas and to know Michael through that connection, through that relationship. And I will tell you, even before we move into our conversation, that he and Rebecca are two of the most passionate believers I've ever known. Their heart for Jesus, their desire to use their incredible intellectual gifts to advance the kingdom, to steward the church, to serve the church, to resource the church, is an ongoing encouragement to me. And so it's an incredible privilege for me to be in this conversation and be able to introduce my friend to you and talk with you together. So, Dr. Lindsay, welcome to our conversation today.
Thanks so much for having me on, Jim.
It's my honor. It's my privilege, Michael. I'm really grateful that you give me this opportunity. So let's start this way. As I mentioned, you have obviously worked at, learned from a variety of institutions, from Oxford, from Princeton, Baylor, Rice, Gordon. And in a moment, we're going to make an announcement as regards Taylor University as well. So what drew you to Taylor? And tell us about the announcement we're making today, the decision that's being shared with the world, and what it was that caused you to believe that this was God's call on your life.
Well, we're delighted to be able to share the news that the Lord has called me to serve as the next president of Taylor University. Mm-hmm. Taylor is a flagship evangelical institution worldwide, and our family could not be more excited to go and serve this amazing institution. Mm-hmm. I've known of Taylor for decades, and having the opportunity to come and serve is extremely exciting. We've known of the institution through its people and just love and appreciate it. Our time at Gordon has been wonderful. I've enjoyed being there for 10 years, but over the course of the last year or so, we got a sense that the Lord might be calling us to a new chapter. And originally, when I had that sense, I wasn't very excited about it because I loved what I was doing at Gordon and thought that I'd be there the rest of my career. But in God's providence, He was preparing us for a new calling. And over the last 6 or 7 months, we've had a chance to explore a variety of different possibilities. And we really think that the Lord is calling us to Taylor. Mm. We've always loved the people we know of the institution, and we're excited about the opportunities that are before us. And we also think that the Lord has really been guiding us throughout this process. Mm. And that all of those things give us great confidence to be able to come and serve this wonderful institution. Taylor is located between Fort Wayne and Indianapolis in Indiana in the America's heartland. It serves about 2,000 students, and the people there have such a vibrant, deep, committed walk with the Lord, but also just a great deal of warmth and hospitality. We look forward to experiencing that Hoosier hospitality as a family come this summer.
In fact, I understand that the Indianapolis Colts are about to be your new favorite football team.
Well, you can't be in Indiana without liking the Colts, so we look forward to being there. We've had a pretty good run in New England with the Patriots, so maybe it could be a luck charm for the Colts as well.
Well, you have a new book coming out entitled Hinge Moments, where you're looking at hinge moments in individual lives, people of enormous influence in the culture, people of enormous leadership impact. As you were writing that book, as you were preparing for that, I can't imagine that you could have a way to know that you were going to be at a hinge moment in your own life coming up, and that now you're making this announcement as regards this enormously significant shift that's happening in your life and really in Christian higher education. When you started all of that, by way of a personal transition in your own research, did you have any sense that you maybe were headed toward a hinge moment like that? Or did you in some ways become kind of the unwitting audience of what you wound up writing?
I did so much. So I was working on this book project, and it was really designed to think about how do people manage change in their life, and how do they sort of go through the internal process of experiencing different stages of transition. I really thought it was a book for young adults preparing for their, you know, getting married or starting a career. But as I was working on the book project, it began to speak to my own life. One night, Arthur Brooks, who had been a very successful head of the American Enterprise Institute after a decade of service, decided to step down, and everybody was very surprised by it. And as Arthur was talking about his own Catholic faith and how that shaped his own sense of vocational calling and his decision to step away from AEI, I got these butterflies in my stomach as he was speaking. I went home that night and I said to Rebecca, what is that about? Why am I nervous about Arthur Brooks' announcement? And she said, well, maybe God is trying to speak to you as well. I said, well, I don't like that story, so I'm not going to think about that anymore. A few months later passed, and I was reviewing all these interview transcripts. I interviewed 550 senior leaders for this book, Hinge Moments. And I came upon this interview with Bruce Kennedy, who at one time served as the CEO of Alaska Airlines. And as I was reading his interview, I was reminded of the story he told about his own decision to step away from Alaska after 10 years on the job. And almost instantly, the butterflies came back in my stomach. I began to think, is God maybe calling me to put aside the Gordon presidency after 10 years? But I worked so hard and I loved the job so much. And I thought we were experiencing, you know, the wonderful blessing. The flywheel was turning. Things were really going in the right direction. But over time, I began to see maybe the Lord was indeed calling me to do something else. And over the summer, so about 6 to 8 months ago, I had this strong sense from the Lord that the leadership team we'd assembled was a strong and capable group of people. And one night we were all gathered at a dinner and I looked out upon the group of colleagues and I had this sense from God saying to me, this is a really talented group. It's okay to pass the baton. I went up to my hotel room that evening and said to Rebecca, maybe God really is calling me to step down after 10 years. We ended up taking the week after Labor Day to really pray and fast and ask the Lord to guide us. And at the end of that week, we had become convinced this indeed was what the Lord was telling us. It was a bit of a scary move for me because, you know, I've never left a job without having another job. But I felt like this was an act of obedience. And so I told my board of trustees that I really felt like this was God was calling me to do it. They were wonderful. And many of them, you know, said, let's give you a break, but let's sign you up for another 5 years. But I really was convinced that the Lord was saying, It's time for this chapter to conclude and for you to be open to another chapter. And so we undertook that process. And as you say, while writing Hinge Moments, I found myself not only writing about it, but also for the book to speak to me. And I hope that other people will be encouraged because each of us experience these inflection points in our life. Some of them are ones that we plan. We just, you know, decide we're going to apply for a job, hoping we'll get a new opportunity, or we propose to somebody and they say yes. Some of them, though, come to us just out of the blue. A loved one dies in a car accident. Or our spouse is diagnosed with cancer. In each of those moments, we're entering into a phase where the Lord can do some pretty amazing things. So I hope folks will pre-order on Amazon, Hinge Moments. It comes out next month. And I hope as they read it, they'll be encouraged to see how God might use a particular season in their life to help change the trajectory for them of greater fruitfulness and faithfulness.
Well, Elton Triplett, I think it was, it said, we live our lives in chapters, right? And each chapter prepares us to write the next chapter. You can't write the third chapter before you write the second chapter. And so it's just really remarkable to see the providence of God in leading you to Gordon when you really had no anticipation. I remember we talked about that. You were incredibly honored at Rice. You were winning all sorts of awards as a faculty member, as a contributing scholar in a variety of different publications. And when God led you to Gordon, that really wasn't your expectation at that point. And now, once again, the Lord is leading you in a direction that wasn't necessarily where a year ago you would have expected. Someone said, if you want to make God laugh, tell him your tell him his plans, right? At the end of the day, it's his plan, not ours, that matters. So talk a little about Taylor with us. Tell us what it's best known for and what it is about Taylor that most excites you.
You know, Taylor has this amazing legacy of probably being the very best in the country among faith-based schools at student development. It's a very student-centered campus culture, and they have amazing traditions, great, vibrant campus life. And all of us who've admired Taylor from afar have always seen that as the great strength of the institution. Also, you know, Taylor is 175 years old, so they've been working at the integration of faith and learning for a long period of time. And because of that, they're really the pace setters of that. Taylor was one of the first institutions of Christian world that had a computer science degree. Taylor just launched two more satellites through a NASA facility in Virginia Beach. So they've been involved in the integration of faith and learning in the sciences for a long time, as well as in the arts. Film is one of the most popular majors these days, and we're hoping to be able to build a building that will help build out that program and help bring more aspiring filmmakers to Taylor. And I think there's some great possibilities. So we're drawn to the place because of the people, because of the culture, and because of the opportunities.
And that's one of the reasons I so resonate with your ministry. What we do at Denison Forum in a cultural apologetics, seeking to equip Christians to respond biblically and redemptively to cultural issues, is so aligned with what you just said, to help students understand those places where media and culture change. What can I do to make the greatest impact, to make the greatest difference? So those that support and pray for and follow your ministry are really making an impact in the larger kingdom of God as a result of what he's gifted and called you to do. And it's one of the many reasons I admire you and what you're doing. So talk for a second, if you would, about Gordon. What are two or three things that you're proudest of from your 10 years there? I could make a long list because I'm familiar with the remarkable progress that was made there over those 10 years, but pick just two or three. And then if you would, two or three things that you hope to bring to fruition in your new responsibility at Taylor.
Well, probably the biggest thing we were excited about at Gordon was what we call the Gordon Game Change, which was a major initiative for affordability. We announced this fall one-third a reduction of the sticker price of tuition and the net price going down for every single both incoming student and returning student. It'll save students thousands of dollars a year, tens of thousands over the course of their Gordon career. That was something we worked on for 7-8 years, systematically trying to reduce expenses as well as grow additional revenues. So we were very excited about that, and I'm proud of the work that our team has done. Also, I'd have to say that the deep commitment to bearing witness to Christ in New England, which is the most pluralistic part of America, and trying to embody the grace and truth of Jesus, the kind of work that happens every single day, the ministry that our faculty and staff provide to our students, I'm really proud of that, and the way that we've been able to be a lighthouse in that part of the world, which I think it's important for there being a distinctive Christian witness. Boston, after all, is home to more college students per capita than any other city on the planet. It's, you know, it's home to more institutions of higher learning than any other place in the world. So it is the global capital of higher education. And within that environment, Gordon has a particular milieu because we're the largest evangelical employer in six states. When our chapel services meet a couple times a week, it's the largest gathering of evangelical Christians in all of New England. So I'm proud of the way in which the college has been able to live into its Christian identity. And in part, that's what draws me to the opportunity at Taylor. Taylor is this gem of a place where chapel is packed, even though chapel is not a requirement for students. Students who are actively committed to growing their faith and living out their faith. Taylor has a long tradition of developing servant leadership, of leadership development of Christians who will occupy positions of responsibility in ministry and the church, nonprofit life, education, science, technology, business, finance. And I love the opportunity to sort of follow in that tradition and hopefully add some additional value. The student focus of Taylor, I think, really distinguishes it from other Christian colleges. It's a place where students are deeply loved and they enjoy the vibrant campus culture. We're so excited to be able to live on the campus. I have three daughters, and they're looking forward to being part of that campus life. We're super excited to be going to Taylor.
I do have to admit that had I not been required to go to chapel at my Christian college, I might not have gone five times. And so that's incredibly impressive to me that it's not required and yet packed. And again, tells you something, doesn't it, about what God's doing on the campus and the vibrancy of spiritual movement. And that's got to be exciting to come and be a part of all of that. Well, as you know, we see this all the time, but there are those who decry Christian education, Christian anything, but special education is kind of learning in a bubble, somehow coddling minds. So I wonder if that's been your experience, since you obviously studied at Princeton and at Oxford. You have a broad base from which to contrast your experience, let's say, with Princeton and Gordon. How would you compare the intellectual rigor between your experience at the evangelical world and what you've seen in the larger academic world?
You know, I teach a class at Gordon that's very similar to the class that I taught at Rice. And I would say the academic quality of our students is very, very similar. The level of engagement with course materials, the degree of preparation, and the forcefulness of their arguments in their papers and their essay exam, they're really impressive. But the thing that distinguishes, I think, faith-based higher education today It's the lone remaining sector of the academy that really prizes academic freedom. There is not a single topic that is off the table. And that's not the case at America's leading universities. I have to say, you know, at Gordon, we're not afraid to tackle difficult issues. And while we all approach our intellectual pursuits from a shared Christian foundation, we're also willing to allow students to grapple with doubt, with questions, with disagreement with the traditional Christian faith. And that kind of openness and intellectual rigor and academic freedom, I don't find to be the case on the Ivy League or on other campuses. And it's one of the most refreshing things that I think we bring to the larger academy is a commitment to pursue truth in every domain and to say we're going to investigate these things clearly within our Christian foundation, but also openly committed because all truth is God's truth.
And that's something I think you bring to the table as well, obviously, having lived on both sides of that context of that debate, as it were, and modeling that effectively as a leadership, as a leader as well. So let's talk about parents for a moment, prospective parents. I am the father of two sons themselves that experienced a Christian higher education and had a marvelous experience. Both of them a very formative experience. So if you're talking to a parent who's considering a college or university for their high school student, what are some intangible outcomes that you think of in terms of a degree from a Christian as opposed to a secular institution?
So the gold standard for evaluating the impact of higher education is a study that comes out between Gallup and Purdue University. It's an index that tries to measure the student experience on a whole host of measures. And at schools like Taylor and Gordon, you would find that the students are reporting much higher degrees of satisfaction, much higher likelihood to say they had a faculty who was directly involved in their life, who cared about their academic formation, who cared about them as a person, who helped them engage in an intellectual pursuit that they were able to carry forward, either through independent study or by working closely with a faculty mentor. In virtually all of the outcomes, schools like Taylor and Gordon really do the very best. And so I can't imagine sending my daughters to anything less than a Christian institution, in part because I take the formation of my kids seriously. And I know that they're going to be shaped deeply by the professors who teach them in class, the coaches who are with them on the athletic field, but more generally, the community that you're a part of. We are known by the company we keep. And so I believe deeply in the value of Christian higher education. I think that probably most Christian parents, most families are completely oblivious to both the hostility toward the gospel and the outright activities of some faculty and staff and other students on secular universities and how they really do want to diminish the salience of the gospel. I'm not interested in building a holy huddle. I'm not interested in sort of putting our young people in some kind of small subculture, but I'm here to say that the college years are where you tackle the big questions of life. It's where you think deeply about who am I? Who has God made me to be? What kind of person do I want to become? It's also a place where you really grapple with your doubts and your questions about your faith. And you need spiritual guides who will come alongside you, both as you deconstruct your faith, but also as you reconstruct it. So you can graduate from university with a much more solid, deep commitment. I'm really proud of the fact that you know, school like Taylor, 10 years out of graduation, students are far more likely to report that they're active in their faith and deeply committed to their faith than other college students. And I think that's because the kind of formation that occurs on a campus like Taylor's allows students to be wholly shaped. Whole person education is what we've been about for 175 years. And it's the kind of formation that I think is worth the investment families have to make in higher education today.
I completely agree. As a father of two sons, as I said, products of Christian higher education, there are people who see a degree like that or an experience like that as an attempt to shelter from the world. I think it's a method of preparing for the world. It's equipping the saints for the work of the ministry. It's the kind of faith-building, character-building experience that will make them more effective in the larger so-called secular culture in a way that will make them missionaries to the culture, to the glory of God, and is absolutely, hands down, I think the most incredibly significantly important investment that we can be making right now is to be encouraging and supporting young people and parents and family and faculty and leaders just like you, because you're on the front edge, you're on the tip of the spear as we're trying to make a difference in this culture to the glory of God. That's why it's so much fun to be a part of this, have this conversation. So let me ask you, what role do you see Christian education playing in that larger, wider culture as you look to the decade decades ahead, not just the coming years, but the coming decade.
I think one of the key things that we have to prepare our young people for is a VUCA world. The U.S. military describes VUCA as four letters: volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity. And so a 21st century college degree is going to have to prepare young people to have the kind of adaptability and flexibility, because two-thirds of today's freshmen in college are going to pursue careers in fields that have not yet been invented. Let me say that again. Two-thirds of current college freshmen are going to pursue careers in fields that, as of today, they do not exist. So we have to give our students a degree of flexibility and adaptability so that they can improvise as they discover new areas. And that kind of volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity is going to require a degree of solid foundational footing to help our young people to understand who they are and the value that they bring. It's not going to be about training for a particular career or trying to land a job after you graduate. It's about preparing for a lifetime of service and commitment. Now, clearly, we got to do a good job of helping those students be prepared with professional skills, understanding the kinds of leadership abilities that they're going to need to manage teams and to create change in their chosen vocations. But I really think the VUCA kind of preparation that you get at a school like Taylor, I'm a big believer that the liberal arts approach to life prepares you for the wide variety of issues you face. 70% of Fortune 500 CEOs today graduated with a liberal arts degree. That's because it prepares them for a whole range of different subjects.
Let me ask a personal question, if I could. Those that are watching our conversation may not know that your father was at one time the head of the PGA, which I think is really fascinating. And your mother, on the other hand, was involved across her entire career, I think, in as a lifelong educator. So what impact has she had on you and your father as well in preparing you for the place of leadership to which God's called you now?
Yeah, so my mom served as head of school at Jackson Prep in Jackson, Mississippi. And I learned from mom a great deal about how you serve your community, your faculty, and your students, and try to embody the mission and values. Mom was always focused on trying to say what is very best for our students. She was a student-centered educator before that was in vogue. And so I learned from my mom the importance of keeping the focus on what is best for the students. And I benefited. I went to the school where she was head of school and saw that to make a huge impact on my career since then. Dad was president for PGA of America. And it was really growing up, seeing my dad try to be involved in leadership opportunities that first got me interested in interviewing leaders in a whole host of different fields. And so being the son of a mom and a dad, both who held leadership positions, I think sort of whetted in me a desire to understand what was the world that they inhabited and how did they manage both the challenges and opportunities that came because of their professional lives, and how did they balance that with their, also their personal commitments. So both mom and dad had a profound impact, both on what I did for my dissertation at Princeton and then my career as a leadership scholar, and certainly has impacted the way I've tried to lead with integrity in my given callings at Gordon and now as I go to Taylor.
Alfred North Whitehead said, great people plant trees they'll never sit under. Your parents certainly have done that, haven't they, in your life and in your leadership and all those that will follow as a result. So, Michael, I have one last question I want to get to in just a moment relative to kind of the future and some lessons we can learn for Christian leaders across the context. But before that, you were speaking a bit about Gordon and the way that God had been at work in those 10 years and just some pretty remarkable ways that the Holy Spirit was on the move. And I know some of those stories. I know some of the personal background behind that. But part of that is something I couldn't get away without asking. While you were there at Gordon, the Lord, through your leadership and this remarkable team that you built, as you said, were able to secure the largest gift ever given to a Christian college. So I'd like you to talk about that for just a moment. Tell us about that experience. Tell us about the family or what it was that caused them to be interested in Gordon. And what is it about that that we can learn as we're trying to encourage more people to invest in the kingdom?
Well, I know a number of your fans, Jim, are leaders of Christian institutions. And I just have to say, it's a great example of the Lord's faithfulness. Early on in my presidency, I had a sense that we needed a transformational gift. And so I began making a daily prayer that the Lord would provide a transformational donor. And for me, that was going to be a really big number. And I wanted it to be something that only God could provide. And I'd go meet people and I'd think, are you the transformational donor? And then they turn out not to be. And I'd be kind of disappointed. And then I'd go to ask somebody for money. And I'd think, maybe you're the transformational donor. And they weren't. But really, for about 4 years, virtually every day, I prayed that the Lord would bring a transformational donor to the college. And I'd love to be able to say that this wonderful family, incredibly generous, responded to a particular ask that I made of them. But actually, they called me up and said, you know, we're thinking about wanting to do something significant for the cause of Christ, and we'd love to be able to support the work you're doing at Gordon. Would you be interested in talking with us? And I knew that this family was wonderful and deeply committed and also had significant resources. And so I said, well, of course, we're thrilled about that. And it took us a while to actually land on what ended up being the largest gift ever given to a Christian college, announced at $75 million, and to really benefit a major segment of affordability to bring a Gordon education within reach for a much larger segment. They created the Global Honors Institute and the Global Honors Scholars Program, which is really designed to be the Rhodes Scholarship for a Christian school. And we're now in our third cohort of students, and it's been a tremendous blessing. But, you know, each of us, I think, have things in our professional life where we're wondering, you know, could God provide? And I'm just, you know, want to bear witness to the fact that you should bring that request before the Lord. If we're willing to pray about the, you know, healing of a loved one or pray for our own spiritual formation, you can also bring your professional cares and worries and ask the Lord, God, would you be willing to do something? And he may not answer that in the first month we pray it, not even the first year. But I do believe that the Lord is honored when we are faithful in prayer. And so this is a family. They're not alums of the institution. They didn't send a kid to the institution, but they just really loved the school. And so it's been a tremendous, great blessing. And we think it will make a lasting impact for the rest of the life of Gordon College. And it's also been a great catalyst for many other people to consider significant gifts for the cause of Christ. And so we rejoice in the faithfulness of God and the way in which he's used this gift to catalyze a whole movement of philanthropy for the cause of Christ.
So, Michael, I need to ask one last question. Out of what I do as a cultural apologist, my calling, as I mentioned, is to help Christians engage biblically and redemptively with the issues of the day. And part of that calling involves trying to see what's coming, what's out there in the near term and the long term that we need to be thinking about, praying about, preparing for right now. Well, I don't know anybody I'd rather ask this question of than you. Given your history, given your story, given the level of influence God has entrusted to you, your ability to look forward, not only as a sociologist and a scholar, but as a leader and as a person who follows Jesus. So if you're speaking to Christian leaders now, evangelicals really kind of across the spectrum who have various places of leadership that's been entrusted to them, what would you suggest to them are two or three things you see coming where we really need to be praying, really need to be preparing, really need to be right now getting ready to be used as effectively as possible for the kingdom?
Well, it's not so much of what's coming as much as what are we experiencing and how is that going to have an implication for us in the months and years ahead. Yeah. First, I think that the church has really got to be at the vanguard of efforts of racial conciliation. Mm-hmm. We are a culture that is really divided by race, and it does not have to be that way. There have certainly been seasons in the Christian church where we've been able to come across different divides. And I think there's an opportunity for us now. But that's going to require for the church not to sort of lag behind, but instead to look for opportunities for us to bear witness to our faith and to draw people to see that racial conciliation is something that we can actually lead the way on. And I recognize that that's messy and difficult, but particularly white evangelicals need to be willing to listen deeply to our brothers and sisters who are people of color, to hear their experiences and their journey, and to say, we are committed to trying to show the love of Christ to a world in need. Number two, I think that the issues around human sexuality, LGBTQ issues, are at the vanguard of what we're going to see, whether it's discussions around the Equality Act in Washington, or even issues of how our workplaces are going to deal with differences. I think it is entirely possible for the Christian community to be true to our traditional Christian teaching on this matter, but also to embody the grace and truth of Jesus Christ, that even those folks who really disagree with us on the issue of human sexuality could say, the Christians do actually embody love, even in the way in which they disagree with us. And that also, I think, points to the third and larger issue, is that we are becoming a culture where even cultural Christianity is going to the side, and there is a lot of cultural pluralism that we face, particularly in places like New England, where I live. We've experienced that in pretty dramatic ways, but it's coming to every single corner in America, where we're going to have to embody the love of Jesus to an environment that doesn't necessarily even think Jesus has something to say to their life. So my hope is that we will be able to take the admonition from John chapter 1. If we're going to be embodying the person of Jesus in our lives, we've got to embody the grace and the truth of Jesus Christ mm-hmm. and how we carry ourselves. And I do think the important work, Jim, that you're doing, the amazing mm-hmm. ministry and platform that you have, help equip us to be like the leaders of Issachar, who understand the times and know what to do.
Exactly right. That resonates deeply with me as well. But I really do believe that these are times where the Lord is calling us to a renewed level of passion for Him and for each other, to model the kind of grace, the kind of love that Jesus modeled, obviously, when He came to seek and to save that which was lost. We often think of a place to which we're called. God had called you to Gordon, now God has called you to Taylor. And we have a sense of kind of a location about that. And clearly that's, you think about Paul and his Macedonian vision, you think about that with Abraham, think about that all through Scripture. But there's also a time to God's calling, isn't there? It's by His providence that you and I are alive right now, and not 100 years ago or 100 years from now, if the Lord tarries. We're missionaries to this day. We're missionaries to this age. And so I would encourage all of those who are listening to this conversation to be in prayer about that place and way in which the Lord is calling you to embody exactly the kind of Christian compassion that Dr. Lindsay was just describing, to take the initiative in making a difference in your spheres of influence to the glory of God. And I would also ask you, if you would, to pray for Michael and Rebecca Lindsay in this day of transition for them and their family. I'm praying for God to use not only what you've done at Gordon, but what you're going to do at Taylor to lead the larger evangelical movement in the context of our impact on the culture. Mark Knoll said, the scandal of the evangelical mind is that there isn't one, as you know. The great need of the day is for evangelical influencers, evangelical intellectuals, to stand up and to use the gifts God has given them to make an eternal difference and impact in this culture right now. And you're at the front of that, my friend. And that's why it's such an honor for me to be in this conversation with you and to be praying for you and to share with you the excitement and the good news about the announcement today. So I'm praying for you. I'm praying for your family. I'm praying for Gordon. I'm praying for Taylor. And I'm looking forward to what God is going to do as the months and years come. All of this, to God be the glory, great things He has done. Thank you for the privilege of this time together, my friend.
Thank you so much. Great to be with you.